glad you all made it today. You want to stay with us this morning for worship? Again, just as a reminder, they are not unprinted. If you'd like to read them instead, they're right next to the bulletins out in the hall. If you want on your way out to look at or read over, you're welcome to do so as well.
Thank you. All right, maybe see the last ushers to come forward for time of offering. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come here on this rainy day, Lord, and just worship you, Lord. I pray that you bless this time of offering, Lord, and bless this time of worship and hearing the word. In your son's name, amen.
Thank you. The fact that Christ died just for the unjust. God's plan was for Jesus to come and take our place in the suffering that we deserve for our sins. And that's an amazing thing. Last week when we were together, we were talking about the fact that there is life after death. That Jesus came and he lived his life and he died, and immediately he went to preach to the spirit in prison, and then eventually his body was resurrected with his living spirit, and then he appeared to his followers, and all those things took place. And I reminded us in the text last week about the reality of about our future life, that none of us, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, when you die, your body is just shed to the ground, but your spirit goes to be with the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And that's exciting. I mean, I don't have to worry about dying if I get in a car crash or whatever, heart attack, aneurysm, that, you know, whatever. If my life is over, I know where I'm going.
Amen.
And that's why I preach the gospel, because if you're here today and you haven't made that assurance, and had that assurance in your heart that you know Jesus Christ is your Savior, that He is your Lord, that He loves you and died for you, then you are at risk. If something happens and you die without your faith in Christ, then there is no hope for eternity. Your judgment is sure. Christ died for us and took our place so that we could put our faith in Him. The scriptures tell us.
Turn that on, so be careful. I finally remember to turn it on. I do that to the sound people every once in a while. I try to test them. So they try to turn up the knobs, and then they still don't hear me, and then finally I turn it on, and I embarrass myself a little bit. I have a few jobs when I start to turn this on and turn the microphone on, and I forget most of the time. But anyways, we're here today. There are some truths in 1 Peter, and we're studying together where faith through the fire is the purpose of this whole study in 1 Peter, because he talks in the very first chapter that though you're to be tested by fire, you might be found unto the praise and honor and glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's dealing with all the troubles and struggles and things that we face in life. And then today we're talking about three lessons from Christ's death about our salvation. 1 Peter 3:18-22 gives us three lessons that we are focusing on. One, of course, is the truth about life after death, which we studied last week. We're going to talk today about, are the scriptures true, even stories like Noah and the flood? And the answer is yes. You know, you go back, and the Bible tells us specific about that, and then we're going to also understand about baptism. So I'm going to move a little faster. Your notes are actually double-sided today, so you can pull out the first part of the green words there on the notes and just follow along, and there's a couple spots to fill in. I took most of them away so that you wouldn't have so much to do today. But are the scriptures true, even stories like Noah? It's a good question for someone to ask. You meet someone and they say, well, the Bible, yeah, but it's full of all these stories, and they're kind of weird, like Noah and the flood. Now, I believe that the story in Genesis about the creation of man and Adam and Eve, I believe that's literally true. I believe everything took place. And when you get down just six chapters later and you hear the story of Noah and the ark and God's preservation, I believe that is true also. Now, I'm not here today to preach through the story of Noah. I wish we had time for all that, but I keep here for a few hours, which I can do. Find a little bit long, but when we're looking together, look at what he says here about the story of Noah. He's declaring for us, he's launching from what he had just said about making proclamation to the spirits of prison. And now in verse 20, he says, "Who those spirits who once were disobedient, when the patience of God was kept waiting in the days of Noah, during the construction of the ark," in other words, about 120 years, God kept waiting because the thoughts of man's hearts, if you follow Genesis 6, it tells you in the first few verses that man's hearts and continually evil, and man had been so corrupt. The sons of God had come with the daughters of men, and everything was wicked and evil. And then God decided that there was one person he would save in his family, and that was Noah. And he would save them in the ark. And so Noah entered the ark. There were eight of them total. But for 120 years, the patience of God was waiting while Noah was building that ark. It's a long time to wait. But you know, when God is looking for someone to be saved, he's very, very patient.
Amen.
Because he wants us to be saved. He gives every opportunity. He knows the hearts. He knows how he created us. So as we're studying together today, just to remind ourselves of these truths. First of all, 2 Peter 1:19-21 declares that the scriptures came to us from God. That's now 2 Peter. 2 Peter says that no prophecy came by its own private interpretation, but
holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And if you turn to 2 Peter, I'm not going to turn there now, but you can turn there later and just look it up. He's just declaring that truth. Or in 1 Peter chapter 3, and we know that God guided the writings of the Scripture in men. And so when you're reading 1 and 2 Peter, it declares clearly the account of Noah's flood as being true. In other words, what Peter writes now is just reflective of what the book of Genesis wrote earlier. In fact, when Jesus spoke about the flood, the same thing takes place. We learn that there were eight persons, only eight persons, saved in the ark. 1 Peter 3:20, if you held your finger there and you turn to 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, it says, For God did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, with seven others when he brought the flood upon the world. For understand that the New Testament bears out that all that you read in the Old Testament is accurate. It's not like you're hypothesizing about things that took place then. They're true and they're real. And so we're in 1 Peter chapter 1 and 2, and we're reading these things. Only eight persons were saved. We understand that to be true. The rest of humanity and the entire world were destroyed with the water that came down. An amazing thing. The scriptures tell us in Genesis that before that time of the flood, that it really didn't rain upon the earth. There was like a mist that would water, and I'm going in a little bit of theology, you've got to understand Genesis, but there was like a mist. And then when the floods took place, there was the first rain that, you know, rainstorms that came down, and also it says that the foundations of the east of the earth broke up, and the waters rose, and everything that was preserved then was all destroyed. And I was thinking about this week, and I was thinking to myself, you know, in those days, really, the nation of Israel didn't exist. There was no land of Israel. There was no land of Illinois. There was no, anywhere, Richmond and Susan or any of that wasn't there. It was all formed again after the flood. It's kind of something to ponder a little bit. But what we're reading here verifies the account of Genesis 6 through 8. You can read it on your own time. Go this afternoon and just pull out your Bible and just enjoy reading what the story that comes through. Isaiah 54:9 declares the same thing. So this Hebrews declares about the reality of Noah and who he was and the preacher of righteousness and how God spared him and his family. All throughout the scriptures, you find that the stories of the Old Testament are once again portrayed. Jesus himself taught the account of Noah and the flood being true. In fact, he accounts for it in a couple different places. I wanted to take a moment, just turn over to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, just to remind you of something, what Jesus said, because it speaks about the future and things that are going to be going on. And so, many times we hear this story, and we look at our day and age today, and we see what's going on. In Matthew chapter 24, you begin reading at verse 37, listen to what he says. Actually, let me read verse 36. It says, but of that day and that hour, that is the coming of the Son of Man, is what it's talking about. But of that day and that hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone knows when that day will come. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like it was in the days of Noah. For as in those days, which were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, they were marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And they did not understand until the flood came and took them all away, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. There are going to be people just ignoring what God is saying. And so if you put that in context and you realize, you know, that the patience of God was kept waiting, Noah started building this ark. And maybe people witnessed it and saw it, and he would declare to them, and the Bible says Noah was a preacher of righteousness. He kept declaring the truth that God was going to judge the world. And nobody listened to him. The only ones that would believe him were his family. They're the only ones that entered the ark. For 120 years, with even an object lesson, Noah was preaching the salvation in God, and no one dared believe. And they kept living their life, just as we stand here in the pulpit today, or you go out and you witness to someone about the gospel of Christ, you tell them you go to church, you tell them that you believe in Jesus, they need to believe in Jesus, and they won't listen to you. And one day, we understand God's Bible prophecy calendar. I believe the next event on God's Bible prophecy calendar is the fact that Jesus is going to come in the clouds, and what's going to happen then is what we call the rapture, that those of us who But first of all, those who are asleep will rise first, and then we who are alive and remain, we're going to be lifted up. We're going to meet the Lord in the air, in the clouds, and so will ever be with the Lord.
Amen.
First Thessalonians 4 tells you the whole account. You can read it for yourselves. And those accounts are true, just as well as we read about Noah and the flood. Jesus said that just like the days of Noah, when God's judgment comes out, they're just going to be ignoring everything. In fact, this isn't even his... Jesus is talking about his second coming, and what we're reading and talking about the rapture, that's not even his second coming. He only comes in the clouds when he finally comes to earth. But people have seen all these things, and they will still be ignoring it. Because some people's hearts get so hard that they just refuse to believe. And sometimes it may even seem right to them, but to believe in Jesus means that I should change my life. And people don't want to do that very easy. And you've got to pray and convince them. Get them to realize that without Christ, it's a hopeless eternity. Now, I can't get too far off the track today. The accuracy of the Bible in our lives. In fact, some of you are going to recognize some of these slides. I've started putting together all the material on That's What I Believe, which is a discipleship course for all of you that I write to get you to understand the doctrines of our faith. And I reflect them off of the doctrines of our Constitution. And one of the first doctrines we read in our Bible, and that's where these slides kind of were taken from, is Scripture. So you read it, if you grab a copy of our church constitution, or what we believe. In fact, if you go in the little rack out there, just outside the back door there's a rack that has our statement of faith, or if you want, there's the whole constitution there. And if you want to join membership, you got to read the statement of faith and make sure you believe in that, and we welcome you to join our membership here at the church. But as you read that, it has different declarations in there about things that we believe as a church body. And this is one of them. We believe that all the scriptures, cover to cover in this book, all the scriptures were given to us by direct inspiration of God through the agency of the Holy Spirit, as 2 Peter chapter 1, 19 and 21 says, and that the Bible is the inerrant word of God in its entirety, the completed canon of scriptures. The canon is... that was a measuring stick by which they would determine which books belong in the Bible, which we teach in that course. And so some of you had that, you can kind of remember that can. I had a picture of a can up there, and that's not what the canon of Scripture is. It's not a big gun that shoots out Bibles. That's not the canon of Scripture. The canon of Scripture is just literally means, the term canon is a term that means that it measures up to the standards that were set forth. And that's why we call it that, but it's kind of fun to play with it. The accuracy of the Bible in our lives, but God's incredible book. This Bible is so awesome and so incredible. I just get shivers sometimes when I just begin to think of and teach about what God did with this book. The Bible was written by at least 40 different writers who were controlled by the Holy Spirit. In other words, God was guiding them as they wrote the things they needed to write over a period of 1,600 years. And yet it all comes together with one common theme, and that is the whole theme of salvation. Salvation through Jesus Christ, who died for us, who was buried, who rose again. The Old Testament points, it points to the coming of the Messiah. The New Testament tells the whole story and waits for the Messiah to come again. It's just a marvelous book of God's prophecy. It was divinely authored through human writers, we understand. It was designed, divinely preserved through human instruments. God had guided them so that they wrote it on the parchments and things were kept, and they found fragments, and I can't go into all that this morning because time doesn't allow us to. But it's amazing, the accuracy of the books that we have. And it's just, I get astounded now. I'm kind of, I love the scriptures. I went to school, I studied both the Hebrew and Greek, I look back at the originals, and I see things, and I just love it. The Bible God gave us is there for us. We can study it. We can know it. It's His word to us. Because God wants us to know about salvation, how to live in salvation, how to follow Him and understand Him. The prophecies of the Bible have either been accurately fulfilled, or there's few that we're waiting to see. In fact, the book of Revelation here tells us about future events. But we know that Micah chapter 5 talks about the fact that Jesus will be born in Bethlehem. We know that Isaiah talks about a virgin we can see. We see that fulfilled in Scripture. Zechariah talks about the Messiah would ride on a donkey and so forth. And we see that fulfilled in Scripture in Matthew's Gospel and elsewhere. And then there's John 14, 1 through 3. Remember what it says? Let not your hearts be troubled. For if you believe in God, believe also in me, Jesus says. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, he says, I'm going to come back. In other words, Jesus said, I'm going to die and I'm going to leave. But when I leave, I'm going to come back and I'm going to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also.
Amen.
Isn't that a marvelous promise?
Amen.
Same thing, but 1 Thessalonians 4, there, Jesus is going to come back and the Father will look forward to that. The prophecies will all be fulfilled. It's so neat to see how God just put little details in the Old Testament, and the Messiah fulfilled all those details. I mean, coming to Jerusalem on a donkey, yes, Jesus did it. Born of a virgin, yes, Jesus did it. In Bethlehem, yes, Jesus did it. You can go on from there. There are so many prophecies that Jesus fulfilled that were just told about in the Old Testament. It's an amazing account. Jesus declared that the scriptures are true and accurate. True and accurate. Matthew 5:18, not one jot or tittle, little markings in the languages that will ever be passed away until they're all fulfilled, is what he says. You can go through the other scriptures. If we accept, Gordon Little writes this, he says, if we accept Jesus to be true and that he is our Savior and Lord, and what Jesus said to be true, it would be contradictory and inconsistent if we rejected the scripture as a word of God to which Jesus stated to be true. In other words, if you believe in Jesus, and Jesus quoted and told, and he always said the scriptures are true, and if you say the Bible isn't true, then there's something wrong. The reasoning isn't good. The Bible is both living and powerful. Living and powerful. Hebrews 4:12 says it's living. And I think to the sense that the way it's living is the fact that when you give it to someone, the Bible has the ability to convict of sin. You can reason with someone all you want in your own meanderings about, you know, God says this and God says that. But I have found when I'm sharing the gospel with somebody, what I love to do is I usually try to keep a Bible somewhere handy. And then when I'm sharing with someone, if they really get interested, I will take out my Bible and I will give it to them and I'll say, would you read this for me? And I'll ask them, tell me what you think that means. And let God speak to them. And what's amazing is that I can sit there and reason with somebody all I want, but if I get them to read scripture for themselves, it's like God just opens a different window. It's like this book has something in it. And it is. God says, it's my word.
Amen.
When my word gets in someone, the literal word of God, it just changes them from the inside out. And it's a marvelous thing.
Amen.
The Bible is powerful. It can dissect with all the thoughts and the intentions of a heart. It changes a life. So the challenge to us is this. We are to confidently follow the word of God. We're to be thankful for our salvation. We're to be resting in his peace that he gives to us, the peace of God that passes all understanding. We're to be on guard against error and wickedness and growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And by the way, that is the way the book of 1 Peter actually closes. Growing grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, in a few closing comments, but that's basically what it says. Peter's goal is that you can be growing in the grace of God, and that's our plan. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, this Bible is true, cover to cover. I always love listening to Kent Holman when he always did this. He says, I believe the Bible is true, cover to cover. He says, even the name on it, it's got my name on it. John Jerry Rosal, that's true too, it belongs to me. He has fun with that. From there, we go on from this study. We're going to continue on. Now, if you got your sermon notes out, flip those over. Because we're going to talk about lessons of Christ's death, about salvation. Only this time, we're going to talk about baptism. Because this is what he does here. So he's talking in 1 Peter, and he's saying, you know, Christ died for us. Jesus, after his death, he was alive and he never really died. I mean, physically, his body dropped off, but spiritually, he's still alive, just like for us. Then he goes on and he says the second thing. He says there's these stories about Noah, and God's patience was just there in the days of Noah. And don't miss God's patience. He's waiting. But then he makes another statement. And he says, corresponding to the story of Noah, baptism now saves you. Now he's kind of taking it as a parallel. He's saying, you know, you've got stories of Noah, how all those people were saved through the ark. He says, so correspond to that. Or a like figure unto that, baptism now saves you. But it's not the removal of the dirt from the flesh, but it's an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven, angels and authorities and powers having been subjected unto him. What an amazing portion of scripture we're reading here. Let's learn a few things. Baptism corresponds to the ark, picturing our salvation. Baptism corresponds to the ark and it pictures our salvation. The same water which drowned the wicked, Homer Kent writes, he says, the same water which drowned the wicked floated the ark and became the means for physical deliverance from the flood. Although physically the ark delivered them from death, spiritually they were saved because they believed in God. They believed enough to build the ark. It was the response of true faith that was called upon that saved them. And that's really what the picture is of baptism. They were brought safely through the water, the scriptures says, makes clear. And as we're reading this together, baptism is a picture or an illustration of what really saves. It's that picture, it's something to help us understand what really saves. And he makes it so abundantly clear. He says it's not the act of going into the water and then suddenly you're cleansed of the dirt and the things that are on your life. That's not what he's talking about. But it's the response when someone says, I believe in Jesus Christ as my Savior, that he died for me, that he was buried, that he rose again from the dead. That's what saves me. It's the response of a good conscience towards God. It's the conscience, it's the decision that's made. Couple things. Verse 21 further explains what is meant. It's so clear. Not the removal of the dirt from the flesh. It's not the act of being washed in water. It is the act of a good conscience, one believing in the resurrection. Notice how the closeness he is to the resurrection. It's not just the fact that Jesus died. Jesus conquered death and gave us eternal life. We don't have to pay for our sins in punishment. We can live with God for all eternity. And baptism is just that illustration of that. Romans 10, 9 and 10 doesn't mention anything about baptism, just about baptism, but it simply just says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you shall be saved. With the heart man believes, resulting in righteousness. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, it has nothing to do with baptism. In fact, most of the time in Scripture, it has nothing said in there about baptism. It's not baptismal regeneration. That's not the issue. The issue is believing in Jesus Christ. Amazing thing takes place when we believe. A good conscience is one which is functioning properly and possesses information that the penalty of sin will not fall. Hence, the rite of baptism is the answer of our approval which the regenerate conscience makes in obedience to God's command. Baptism is the individual's assent to the fact of salvation and a public testimony of the same. In other words, it's not the act. I can go to a baptismal tank, and if I don't believe in Jesus Christ, I'm not going to be saved. If I don't believe in the resurrection of Christ, if I'm baptized, I'm not going to be saved. The reality of the matter is I was actually baptized as a little baby. I was actually termed the Catholic Church uses a christening. I had no idea what was going on. I was only a week or two old when they put me in this little, which is kind of embarrassing. You ever seen the picture of somebody being christened? They put me in, not bad for a girl, but for a guy, they put you in a little dress. And I understood that. I don't know if they still do that in the Catholic Church. I did cross-dress one time, I guess. Not by my own will, but they put me in this little thing, and then they put me over a tank or a little trough, and then they poured water over me, and I was baptized. At least my parents said it would happen, and I had godparents who said the same thing happened. That didn't save me. I had no idea what was going on. I didn't believe on Jesus Christ in those days. That doesn't save us. The reality is I've got to come to a point where I believe that Jesus died and was buried and rose again.
Amen.
It's the only thing that's saved. Amen. Acts 16:31, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Now, many people are soon baptized. Baptism is a beautiful, beautiful picture. In fact, I meant to bring a marker board here today and I forgot. Too bad Don doesn't drink more. I better turn them around and draw on it. Because when I baptize somebody, I always draw a picture. And I draw a picture of what baptism represents, and I can't do it now because I didn't bring my marker board. But basically, when you draw the picture, you see the cross where Christ died. And when Christ died, they took him down from the cross, and then they laid him in the grave. And they put him in there, and he was covered over. And then the Bible says that he rose again from the dead and came out of the grave. But when you're in the waters of baptism, it's the same thing for you. You come down into the waters, and when you're put in the waters of baptism, you're brought under the water like you're identifying with the death of Christ, that Jesus actually died for you. And then when you go in the waters, I always tell somebody when I'm praying for baptism, I said, now, do you stay in the water? I love to get the answers to that. No. Why? And usually it's because, well, I, I die, I drown, but if somebody's, if we, I've done my job right, and I've read the scriptures, Paul will say, well, no, because Jesus didn't stay in the ground, he rose again from the dead. That's exactly right. So you pull him up out of the water, and it's a picture that you died with Christ, and that you were buried, and you rose again. And it's the same thing for you. It's, you are just identified fully with Jesus Christ. And see, I think it is a beautiful, beautiful illustration for God to help someone believe so that they really understand what they were doing at baptism. They were fully identifying with Jesus Christ. Baptism corresponds as a figure, a picture, a type of what Jesus Christ did. By the act of baptism, a person is demonstrating the saving faith found within their heart. And I want you to understand that. Let me go through some things here fairly quickly, but help you understand. By the act of baptism, a person is demonstrating their saving faith. It's not that the baptism saves you. You could be baptized. I could go into a car or a garage and I'll turn into a car. I can go into places and, you know, I can go to McDonald's and I'll become a Big Mac. It's the way it is. When you go into the waters of baptism, you don't become a Christian. You already be a Christian already. You believe, and now you're doing that just to show your identity with Christ. And if you're here today and you've never followed Christ in the baptism, the believer's baptism, talk to me. I'd be glad to fill the tank and have a Sunday service again and put as many as want to go in and go through the waters. It's a marvelous thing.
Amen.
You know, I think one of the priority things of baptism is that when a new believer comes to know Christ as their Savior, it's like, well, and I want my family to know, I want somebody else to know, I want my friends to know. And it is so awesome to have a baptismal service and to invite your friends. And then we get a chance to just share the gospel, what's going on and what they're doing and why, and so-and-so believe that. And you can picture that for your friends so that they can understand now why you're what you believe about Jesus Christ, that he died for you, and that your faith is in him. And I always take time to respond and explain. Probably one of the best passages for baptism is Romans chapter 6. And let me just read a few verses for you. Kind of spells it out for us in a sense. He says here, or do you not know, verse 3, that all who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore we have been buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so too we might walk in the newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. And the whole point of it all is this: knowing that our old self was crucified with him, that our body of sin might be done away with, and that we should no longer be a slave to sin. For he who has died is free from sin. And the reality is that when you're baptized, you're going to realize that just as Christ rose from the dead and walked forth in the newness of life, we are to be walking in a new life as a believer. The Holy Spirit is working within us, changing us from the inside out. We become a new person. Paul writes in Corinthians, he says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things pass away, all things become new. Because in baptism, we're identifying with the fact that when Jesus died, he came forth to a new life. And Peter is writing these things for the followers of Christ to be reading them so that they realize that they are to be walking in the newness of life. We've been talking about that. Christ was our example. In fact, Christ himself was baptized. Matthew 3 says this is necessary to be fulfilled of things. 1 Peter 2:21 says that we should follow in his steps. So I believe that as a believer, if Jesus was baptized, you should get baptized. Second thing to understand, Christ has, and his disciples baptized people. You can look through the different verses and see how they baptized them. They immersed them in water. Christ's followers regularly baptized believers. There's a whole string of verses. You can see Acts 2 and Acts 8 and Acts 9 and so on and so on and so on. You can go through them. By the way, I was baptized as a baby. So, wasn't that sufficient for me to be baptized? And the answer is no. And so I was baptized again. Pastor Miller did my baptism as a believer in Jesus Christ. And you know, if you go to Acts chapter 19, verse 5 tells you that those who were baptized in John's baptism, in other words, John the Baptist was around, he was baptizing people. These people said, now we have heard about Jesus. They told him about Jesus. And you know what they did? They baptized him again. Only now in the baptism of the Lord Jesus Christ, because now they're a believer. And I think it's proper if someone is 8-10 years old and they were baptized, but they never believed Jesus Christ, and now they're 21 and they receive the Lord as their Savior, they want to get baptized again. It's okay for them to be baptized and go back in the waters and say, you know, this time I'm doing it because I believe. It's my faith. And I'm showing you my faith. This is what I believe in Jesus, that he died in my place. Becoming confident in our faith. You know, the last verse, this is so interesting. The way Peter ends this chapter, but it's really just a dialogue continuing on that chapter. But he says this, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is now at the right hand of God. He's gone into heaven. After all the angels and the authorities and the powers have been subjected to him. And you might connect that with the idea of what he did in verse 18 and 19 when he went and preached to the spirits in prison. Because I believe he was proclaiming the victory that he had and that he was declaring that, yes, I died. And Satan probably was thinking when Jesus was getting ready to go down that cross to Calvary to hang on that cross, he's thinking, you know, I'm going to win this. Jesus is going to be dead and God's plan is thwarted, and then all of a sudden Jesus comes forth from the dead and he rises, and then Jesus goes and declares that victory, and that may well have been what happened. Now that's my thought on it. But to realize that everything is subject unto Jesus Christ. Everything. All angels and powers and authorities. Now people are allowed to do things. God doesn't have his hand controlling everything in the world, otherwise our world would be entirely different. That's not his plan yet. He's got a plan that will unfold. We'll see what the millennial kingdom will be like in a little bit. When we end up in the book of Revelation, we'll understand a bit more about those things. But God's not ruling with an iron hand. He's allowing man to see his own sinfulness in the ways. The confidence of our faith, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ, we believe in that. The safekeeping of the eight in the ark, we believe in that. We believe in the action of baptism, that that's what saves us. It's the reality of the good conscience. All remind us of the triumph in Christ whom we believe for our salvation. We believe. So the question is there today, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior? Let me give a conclusion. The focus of 1 Peter 3, 18-22 is to understand our salvation. So that we understand it. Christ died for our sins one time for all of us. He was the just one for the unjust one, for the sinner, that John Rosal is the one who's lied and done things that are disobedient to God. But Jesus took my place one time for all. I don't have to be saved over and over again because Jesus did once. Well, he knew who I was, and when I received him, he took away my sins. It's that picture. And then we realize that Jesus isn't the big. That's what they say. That's why I'm glad we sang Victory in Jesus today, because I thought it was like perfect. Well, I don't know if you knew that or not. They just chose a song. It is so cool sometimes. A lot of times my messages, they have a song that opens or is in their thing that just like is like the perfect one that I was thinking about when I was writing this, and they sing it. So pretty cool that God just does that. The fact that Jesus suffered for us, he died, was buried, and rose again is the basis of our salvation. Amen?
Amen.
One of the pastors go to 1 Corinthians 15, you'll see it written out there. Christ died for us according to Scripture, was buried, and rose again according to the Scripture. It just says it. This is the gospel. The judgment of God on sin is patiently waiting for those who do not believe. In fact, if you want a better picture of this, we're not going to be studying 2 Peter unless I do it in a quick format. But 2 Peter chapter 3 is one of those passages that people refer to a lot. And what it says is this, and starting in verse 8, it says, but do not let this one fact escape your notice, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like one day. Now ponder that for a minute. One day with the Lord is like 1,000 years. In other words, God is eternal. And 1,000 years to him is like one day. It doesn't matter. He's going to exist. He always has existed, and he always will exist. But for us, you know, sometimes they have one more day, which just means so much. And so he says, you know, with the Lord, he says, don't let us keep your fact that God is so patient. Because then he goes on to say this, the Lord is not slow about his promise. That is talking about the judgment that will come. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some of you count slowness, but is patient toward you. He is not wishing for any to come, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Then he says, but the day of the Lord will come. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens shall pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will all be burned. burned up, just as they were in the days of Noah. Thinking it'll never happen, God's judgment will come. But the Lord is very patient. That's why some say, you know, well, look, our world now is getting so much worse. It is getting worse. God's gospel grace needs to shine even brighter and brighter. And you and I are his witnesses to do those things. And so let me close with these thoughts. Do you know that you are saved and going to heaven? That's my question today. If you're sitting here, do you know that if you die, you go to heaven? If there is any doubt in your mind that when this service closes today, come and say, Pastor John, I just want to talk to you. I want to make sure that I know I'm going to go to heaven. What does the scripture say? Well, I'll open the Bible and let you read for yourselves. Or see Pastor Miller or someone else and they can help you through it. But the Bible is so clear. So clear. You can know that you're going to heaven. These things, the Apostle John writes that these things are right to you that you may know that you have eternal life and may believe. And then finally, are you obediently following God's word? Because all this was written, not just to write it down, but so that you and I could see what was here. And as Peter of Exodus says, the growing grace and the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, that we are ready to give the answer to someone who asks the reason of the hope that is in us, that we, in our trials and troubles and the things of life that are plaguing us, we're just ready to witness. Is that you? Let's pray together. Father, I pray for all who are here today. Lord, all these things were written for our growth, for our salvation, for your love for us, to declare your truth. Father, speak to us today. Change the heart. There's someone here who doesn't know you. Give them the boldness to ask about the salvation that's just waiting for them before it's too late. And Father, for each believer here, I pray that the reality of what we're studying, that they would take these notes home, that they would learn, that they would be ready to witness, to share the truth of the Word of God, to be equipped for every good word. And Father, you would be glorified through our lives. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
You know, as we close today, there are some announcements that I've got to remind you all of, so I'm going to do that. One of them, in your bulletin, you'll find a nice bright yellow form. On one side is a connection to ladies' ministry. On the other side is some information that's new. It says Missions Emphasis Sunday. So pull out your iPhones or your Android phone or whatever it is and go to Sunday, October 11th, and mark on their church dinner. And you're going to be there that Sunday. You're going to stay after the worship service. We're going to fellowship dinner. And it's all to remember our missionaries. We're going to be focusing on missionaries that Sunday. It's Mission Sunday Emphasis. And there'll be tables downstairs that will tell you all about the different missionaries and what they do. And then you can do something special. When you leave today, if you've noticed, there were jelly jars out there on the counter. It's like 20 and 29 of them. The jelly was really good. There's jelly jars out there, and they're basically just so that you can save your change and stuff, and it's going to go to the missionaries from our church. It's all going to be put together and then divided out to the missionaries that we support. So you can give that way to missions in a special way, just a special opportunity. So I just remind you of that. All the information is here, so you can know about that. I just don't want you to miss out on that. And then, ladies, make sure you read about the different Bible studies that are available to you. They're all spelled out here for you. They're going to be studying Revelation by MacArthur, so it's going to be a good study. As you open your bulletin, there's a couple things in there. Their IFCA quizzing is today, but also men, there is more information now on the golf outing. So you can look forward to the time of fellowship on December. Use orange balls. That's September 19th. Hopefully there will be no snow September 19th. But 9 o'clock in the morning, we'll meet here, and I'll head over to Hickory Knoll, I think, or meet at Hickory Knoll, I guess, right? So all the information's there, and then thank you for all the work at the five-day clubs. There's some notes there for you, and of course, your prayer list is in the bulletin along with sermon notes. And I don't know if there's anything else I need to remind us of. There is floor hockey, and we're going back now to Tuesday nights, and it'll be every other Tuesday, so if you want to come and join. Tuesday night this week, the hockey is 7 o'clock, and hope that you can be there. So, anything else?
I want registration on Wednesday.
This Wednesday? All right, officially, this Wednesday is the Awana Club registration. So, bring your children, if you have children that age, or your grandchildren, or great grandchildren, or great great anything else? Wednesday at what time? I'm sorry.
6:30.
6:30 p.m. until like
7:30.
Okay, so we've got a window of time. So if you know anybody looking for registration for Juana's, Wednesday night is it. So.
Oh, I was saying, if you have the old ladies' newsletter, it was a pink color. We ended up adjusting the Bible studies, like you said. Both the morning and evening groups wanted to study Revelation instead of doing separate studies in the morning. So we're doing Revelation morning and evening. And then we have a really cool study on Sunday morning, up in the classroom, where we have coffee and just take prayer requests and share burdens. And then we have some for studying, like around Abraham and other people in the Bible, like Gideon and Moab, just through their faith even when they struggle. And so it's just, but the new newsletter is blue because we had to change it to accommodate what people wanted to do. So it's blue if you want to take that.
All right. Let's stand together. We'll have old days. Let's stand together, and as I close in prayer after we're done, just take a moment and visit someone that maybe you haven't seen in a while or you don't know them, and just shake their hands and welcome them. Let's pray together. Lord, guide us by your grace. Guide us with your love. Guide us by the power of your Holy Spirit just oozing through our lives so that others would wonder who we are, why we have such hope. Help us, Lord, to grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. And all God's children said,
Amen. Amen.